Yesterday, I put my seal of approval on Unitarian Universalists and Quakers, and I did that for a number of specific reasons. Some of them are anthropological reasons that I believe are very important. They deal with the authenticity and the aesthetics of any spirit. One of the greatest influences on Western philosophy, and one of the people who reconciled a lot of your church and state issues and helped to form your law, and just somebody who really makes a huge impact on philosophy in English speaking and German speaking and French, and you know, anyone who's in the west of the Western Europe and the United States, those countries all owe a great deal of their philosophical structural paradigms to a guy named Hegel. And the interesting things that Hegel did was he did work on what's called dialectics. He also had a theory of everything. He didn't call it that. He worked on something called dialectics, which is basically Tai Chi. And it's very, very, very similar, basically, to the Analects of Confucius. And Hegel and Confucius are probably the same being, if not, the same kind of avatarish. That's the character that both of them are playing in the worlds of their time. And they still play, more than the role that they played in their individual lives in reality, is the role that their legacy plays in the sociolinguistic groups that carry their ideas seriously, that take them seriously and carry them on. So he worked on dialectics, which is basically Tai Chi for societies, for social order, and he also worked on something called aesthetics. And aesthetics is actually a science of the quality of spirit. And a lot of people don't know this. At any rate, I'm not going to talk about that today. What I'm going to talk about is I'm not going to talk about the aesthetics of the anthropology of aesthetics of authenticity that give my seal of approval to Quakers and Unitarians. And I also like the church, the Center for Spiritual Living. I like those a lot too. Those are always really good. And there's other places that are really good. Buddhist places are really good. A lot of New Age places that are really good. A lot of people who are really good in general. And I'll tell you right now, one of the reasons that I hold them in such high esteem is because any place that's militantly pacifist, which means not militantly pacifist like they're fighting for peace, which is a complete non sequitur, but moving forward, militant pacifism means that people need to organize peace, and that peace needs to have a structure that's vertical and horizontal. there we go. Sorry, I don't know why I pulled up. A structure that's vertical and horizontal, like a Descartesian plane, or a Gnostic cross, or the symbol of structural philosophy here in the West, which is that symbol there. So to have any kind of cohesive thing happen, you have to have structural integrity that means vertical and horizontal integration. And so the aesthetics of a church have components that are real. I'm not going to talk about this today. They're there, and we count them, and they count, and they make up everything, and you can move them around to a certain extent, like blocks in a paradigm made of Legos. So parts are interchangeable, and pieces can be removed, and if it's not working, you could just get rid of it, and you could add things that you never thought were possible, and wow, they work. And that's how the universe is. It's always breaking down into little patterns, and it's all interchangeable bytes and blocks of the same big energetic whole, which is defined by Tai Chi. And we're not going to talk about this today. So what I'm trying to talk about is joining groups and why joining groups is such a problem for people who apparently are more enlightened than others. And this is true, you know. People who are individuals don't always especially fit in with what has especially been traditional institutional organizations in at least the United States over the last 50, 60, 100 years. Those individuals, they find a certain amount of solace and comfort in being alone, and they find a certain amount of intellectual integrity in standing on their own principles and their own ideas. Therefore, they have no interest in joining groups or going to be part of any kind of structure of others. So church hopping is a pill that you take for this. You just take some church hops, and then you call me in the morning, and what we talk about is how, wow, you can move in and out of these groups, because what we're asking you to do is not join any of them. We're asking you to join them temporarily. We're asking you to sit in as a part of an anthropological field immersion program of spiritual ambassadorship that will create interfaith bodies in real time. We're asking you to make an interfaith ecumenical network possible so that churches can evolve past the bullshit. And when we have all of the churches in line and they are doing what the people want and they are serving the needs of the planet as they're moving forward, everything is going to get a lot better. Trust me. The abandonment of social organizations is a problem, and it's why everything is fractured, and it's why society is so broken, and it's why many people are so isolated. And it's not healthy and it's not helpful. It prevents people from organizing themselves to react to real problems in real time. And it's just basically overall kind of a cancer that eats away the thin veneer that is social relationships before we're just like, coming at each other with crossbows and shotguns, and our brains coming out of our heads in a fucking, zombie situation. Yeah, doesn't that sound? That's again. So we're not asking you to join a group. See, here's the thing with the institution and all. If you're here, you're already here. You're already in. You don't get out. Not even if you die. This is for life, beyond birth and death, right? You just joined a gang that is eternal. Okay? This is not ever become not everlasting. All right? The institution of none and all is at once the oldest and the newest religion that anyone has ever experienced on planet Earth. You're all part of it. You cannot get out of it. And I have always been the leader of it. And it will never, ever, ever change. Okay? Now that we've established that permanence is impermanence and impermanence is permanent, I am not asking you to join any of these groups. I'm asking you to go there. I'm asking you to be polite. I am asking you to sit through their bullshit and check yourself and your observations against your prior beliefs and biases. And I am asking you to listen to these people with your full attention. And do not fold to them. Do not ask them questions. Do not speak your point of view. Learn how to have civil engagements with others in real time that don't involve stereotypes or rash judgments. And you may go and you may be like, wow, all of my stereotypes and my rash judgments were completely confirmed. And then you can report that. And it will make any kind of sense. You see, and this is the response to people who say that science and religion cannot be conjoined. Science makes itself distinct from all other human ventures as the one that can be conjoined with everything. And anthropology is the only science that can be it is already conjoined with everything, because anthropology is the study of all things human. It is the study of all your technology and all your information and all your philosophy, and it includes your religion. And any anthropologist who's ready to throw religion out or under the bus or to not take it into consideration is not really that holistic, or, you know, there are things going on. Now, many of us, we're going to talk about the deeper currents in the world. And that's what somebody I know is going to be like, hey, dude, what's up, man? Can we talk about something juicier than the bones of the dust of the earth? By the way, this is the last note. Oh, wait, there's two more notes. So the second to last note is going to be on ceramics. I have a ceramic bowl. And if you've ever had ceramic bowls, and they're especially the ones that say, like, don't heat them in the oven, and then you heat them in the oven anyway, what you'll notice after time, especially if you let water sit in them and they get kind of like moldy in there and stuff, is that you'll have all these cracks in the ceramic, right? So you have this earth that's been molded, and then it's been baked, and then it's been put under stress, right? And it cracks into all these little perfect pixels, and it looks exactly like your election map. You draw your own conclusions. The baked earth under stress, always forming this exact same pattern. Okay, so then the other thing is answering every question at all times. From now on, I want all of you to remember this. The answer is always yes and no. And if it's not yes and no, if it's yes or it's no, then there better be a damn good reason for it. But no more yes or no. Yes and no. When you get to yes and no, you're almost there. You're ready for all this juicy stuff, which is coming tomorrow. But we'll never get there because we're not going to talk about it later.